Okay, so good afternoon. Welcome to this edition of the Power and Energy webinar series from Inesc Tech. So the topic for today, we'll have two speakers, João Silva and Jesse Miley. They will talk about a concept we developed some years ago for the coordination between TSO and DSO, that is the flexibility map that allows DSO to communicate how much flexibility they have in terms of active and reactive power on the distribution grid to the transmission grid. So we'll have two speakers. We will start on this session, in this first presentation with João Silva. I think before going to the presentation from João, some rules about the questions. So we will take questions in the end of the two presentations. So please use the Q&A window you have on Zoom, but if you want, you can also raise your hand, and then we'll move you as a speaker, and you can make the question live to the two speakers. So let's start with the first presentation. So João Silva have a master's degree in electrical and computer engineering. He's a researcher at the Center for Power and Energy Systems at Inesc Tech. He have been working multiple European projects. In fact, on these projects, it was where he developed these concepts. He also works on operational planning of distribution grids by exploring optimal power flow algorithms. And he's finishing his PhD degree in electrical and computer engineering, also at the Faculty of Engineering of the University of Porto. So, João, the floor is yours.
First of all, thank you for being here today in this new Power and Energy webinar series, where me and my colleague Jesse Miley will discuss about the TSO-DSO cooperation topic. A topic that, in fact, does not have so many years of research. I remember that we started these discussions in between 2012, 2013. Now it's completely different. The topic is very well documented. And as such, what I am going to show to you today, it's the basis of this research, how we reach this flexibility area concept. And then my colleague Jesse Miley will discuss with you some more developments that we made in the last couple of years. So the first thing that we need here to discuss is why TSO-DSO coordination, why it is necessary. As we all know, distributed renewable energy sources started increasing their penetration in the distribution grids a long time ago, and it is continuing this process. It is also very well documented that this increase of penetration has led to technical problems to the distribution system operator in terms of voltage stability, branch overloads, and so on. But it was not so well documented in the time when, by the time that we started this investigation, the problems that this could have for the transmission system operator. And the reason why is simple, is because the penetration level did not yet by that time reach the level that would frequently cause the inverse power flow phenomenon. But now this is becoming to being different. And because of that, the TSO also needs to pay attention to these problems of brought by the increase of renewable energy source penetration. And so we need to find a way to tackle these problems for both system operators, while of course continuing this penetration of renewable sources, because this is necessary for environmental reasons. And so where is the source of the solution? The source of the solution is exactly on the same spot than the source of the problem. The distributed renewable energy sources or other distributed sources can provide for both system operators flexibility. And flexibility is what is the ability that these assets have from moving to their current active and reactive power operating point to another one in response to an external request. However, these resources are mainly located, as we know, in the distribution grids. So how can both operators benefit from it? And that's the first question. Can the TSO use this flexibility? How the TSO perceives this flexibility? Because it's very different the way that he perceives and the way how the TSO perceives it. The TSO is only interested in seeing how the flexibility exploitation will impact in his observability area, particularly in the end of his observability area, which is the TSO-DSO boundaries. But in the DSO point of view, the story is different. The DSO also wants to share the benefits of this flexibility exploitation, and he needs to pay attention if this exploitation will not lead to technical problems on his grid. And that's when, departing from these questions, we came up with a flexibility area concept. This area that you can see here illustrates a set of active and reactive power operating points in the TSO-DSO interfaces that can be feasible, that they are reachable by exploiting flexibility that is on the distribution side and while does not jeopardizing distribution network operation. And by jeopardizing, we mean by respecting the grid technical constraints on the distribution side, voltage limits, branch capacity limits. So every single point we ensure, this map ensures that every single point inside it can be achievable by exploiting flexibility on the distribution side, okay? Also, you can see here different colors, and these different colors are cost areas. For example, what this tells us, if, for example, we want to move the current operating point, the white point that you can see in the middle, to the yellow region, we know that this is possible, and we also know that it's possible by paying a maximum of 25 euros hour. So for the TSO to move the operating point at the TSO-DSO interface to the yellow region, it will pay a maximum of 25 euros per hour for the flexibility exploitation that is on the distribution side. Now a little roadmap of what we made in the last years of research. We started by this concept, as I previously shown to you. Then we went with this concept to the Evolve DSO project, where we not only tested it, developed it, but we also demonstrated it in the field with NADs and now RH. And the tool was completely integrated with the DSO internal systems, and the operator was constantly observing the results and giving us feedback. Afterwards, we got our first publications. The first one is the complete description of the algorithm, and the second one addresses some new challenges that Jean will discuss afterwards in this discussion. Also, Jean will discuss about this problem, the problem of the impact of the discrete variables. I also show here to not, let's say, cut the roadmap. This is one of the parts of our research, and this was also demonstrated in an European project, the TDX Assist. Another stage, it's still being developed, it's still ongoing in the UCFlex project, and it is related with when we desire to estimate flexibility areas for more than one TSO-DSO interconnection. In this case, if we do not take into account the impact of the transmission network in the powerful redistribution throughout the several primary substations, we will not be able to have a correct estimation of the flexibility area. So we need to include the transmission network impact when we want to estimate flexibility areas for more than one interface substation. But today I am not going to discuss a lot about this because this would lead to another webinar, and so I will go to the concepts and to the basics. And so how will you estimate this flexibility area? A simple approach would be, of course, to sum up all the flexibilities that are available on the distribution side in terms of active and in terms of reactive power, maximum and minimum of flexibility that can be provided upward and downward, and we would get a rectangle like this. However, this is not possible because first, there is an interdependency between active and reactive power, and second, because the distribution network constraints lead to a flexibility area shape that is not, it is irregular, it is something similar like this that you can see here. So, having this in mind, we needed to find a way to find these limits, so the flexibility area perimeter points. And how we have made this? Based on the optimal power flow concepts, that we know that usually the objective function of the OPF is the minimization of the active power costs to feed the demand on the distribution side, and while respecting the distribution network constraints, we thought to pick up on this algorithm and changing his objective function, and changing the objective function so that we could minimize the sum of the active and the reactive power in that can be exchanged in the TSO-DSO interfaces. And coupling to each one of these variables two weights, alpha and beta, that by changing them, we, in geometrically speaking, we start defining a family of straight lines with different slopes. And these straight lines intersect the peaky plan in different directions. And so we become able to not only pick up the minimum of active and reactive power, but also all the other points that compose the flexibility area perimeter. Going a little bit deeper into the algorithm. The algorithm, we started by performing the optimization with these parameters alpha and beta that you can see here, since they allow us to extract the maximum of active and reactive power and the minimums. With that, we have a first idea of the flexibility area perimeter. And afterwards, we observe each two consecutive points that were obtained, and we define the straight lines between them. And now I will show to you, I will draw here something to you to explain better this idea. Let me only pick up here the draw. So imagine that we, in the first stage of the process, we have drawn these three points. So minimum of reactive power, maximum of reactive power, and maximum of active power. We then define these straight lines that connect each two consecutive points, okay? We extract the slope of these straight lines, and with that slope, which is this theta nu that you can see here, we are able to intersect the peaky perimeter in another direction. So with this new optimization process for theta nu, we are able to estimate a new point, a new active and reactive power operating point between E and E plus one, which were the previous points that we extracted. We continue extracting new points while the difference between these new thetas and the thetas that led to the previous active and reactive power points is still above a tolerance that is defined by us. When does not comply with this criteria, it means that it's not necessary to continue the exploration of the search space. I'm sorry, I need here to extract these draws. Okay, so these are the tangent lines that I was referring that you can see here in black. So these explore all the search space, all the perimeter, and we are able to get a map like this and a map like the ones that I previously showed you. The operating point can be moved inside it, and we ensure that this will not lead to problems for the distribution side. The cost functions that I previously mentioned to you, I show here. So how we constrain the optimization problem to this maximum cost, we define the maximum costs and the flexibility exploitation. So the cost of activation of flexibility of each resource is summed up and needs to be less than the maximum cost that we set. By changing these maximum costs, we are able to obtain different areas with different colors. Now, a little bit of a problem that we afterwards addressed, the existence of non-convex areas. We understood that this is possible, the arising of non-convex areas, and the prior algorithm that I showed to you, the prior idea, would fail a bit in these non-convex areas, because they extract the first point that the straight lines intersect. When you have a non-convexity, I will pick up here this small video. When you have a non-convexity, this part here, the straight lines will always fall or on this point or on this point. You will not be able to draw these points here. And so we need to adapt a bit the algorithm. To do so, what we have made was first to run a single optimal powerful algorithm, which allows us to obtain a peaky point, an active and reactive power point inside the flexibility area. And then instead of using the objective function, we settled the weights into a constraint that it's a new constraint to the optimization problem, which is geometrically described by a straight line that intersects these active and active reactive power point that we previously extracted, okay? And by changing the alpha and beta of this constraint, we change, of course, the direction of the straight line, and by maximizing and minimizing the objective function, we are able to extract these blue and red points that we can see here. So this is a workaround that allows us also to estimate flexibility areas in non-convex, when we have non-convexities. The impact that we had on the state of the art. We had two journal publications. We had 7 conference publications, participated in 3 European projects, and only with the journal publications, we got more than 100 citations. But this slide is not for this. This slide is to show not that we got more than 100 citations, but that we settled a new paradigm in the state of the art. And after our work, there were several works that continued the path that we started. And this is what science is about. We started with an idea. For example, we did not make benchmarking of the algorithms that we have used to estimate these areas. And then other authors picked up on this and improved and made different things and made different testing. For example, I will show to you, for example, Daniel Contreras tried to, instead of using a non-linear optimization, as we have used, you have used the interior point method, he tried to define this flexibility area following a linear approach, so a linearized version of the optimization problem, and he got a good trade-off between accuracy and computational effort. Also, another very interesting work, it was the work of Pierluigi Mancarella, in which he distinguished feasibility and flexibility operating regions, because feasibility operating regions for him, and it's perfectly acceptable, the definition, consists on the set of active and reactive power points that are achievable in a given amount of time. So in the flexibility area that we define, we do not enter with the ability to respond in a subsecond of time. But here, these feasibility operating regions enter with this in the discussion. And this is very, very interesting. And so, to conclude my presentation, we clearly established here a decision-aid method capable to effective answer to the flexibility recognition problem. We made also a data-driven approach to computer emission network equivalence to address the problem that I mentioned on stage 3, that it is not addressing this webinar, but we will have other opportunities. And then we also address the impact of discrete variables through meta heuristics. Just while we will afterward, my colleague will afterward talk about this. Some possible developments of this, because the developments never stop, move from a single period approach to multi-temporal analysis and also incorporate intertemporal characteristics of resources such as storage devices. I would like to thank you for being here. I expect that I was clear to you. My email is on the first slide that will be shared with you. If you have any idea, if you have any question, please feel free to contact me. And thank you again.
Okay. Thank you, João. Okay, so as I said, we'll take all the questions in the end. I see already here one question. There is also a reason why we're taking these questions in the end. It's because João is, as we speak, answering also some questions because he's defending his PhD thesis today. So the discussion of the thesis was scheduled for the same time of this webinar, so that's why he recorded this presentation. And then we'll take the questions in the end also with Je, because Je was the co-supervisor of João, so he knows the work very well. I was also co-author in some of the papers, so I also know the work very well. So we'll move now to the presentation of Je. So Je is a PhD degree from the Politecnico de Turin in Electrical Engineering. Currently is an associate professor at Université Officielle de Rwenzori, I hope I pronounced correctly, from the Democratic Republic of Congo. He was a senior researcher until 2019 at Inesctec, and currently is affiliated research at Inesctec, and is starting again a collaboration with Inesctec in this area. So he's working in different domains of energy. I would underline the last one, this large-scale electric grid optimization, because Jay is one of the few persons I know in the world that it's really an expert on optimization of electrical grids, and have been doing a nice work on this area. So Jay, now I give the floor to you.
Hello. I hope that you can hear me.
Yeah, we can, John.
So, good morning or good evening, according to where you are attending this webinar. It's a pleasure to me to share with you what we achieved in the last years, leading to the PhD thesis of João Silva. As he said before, my contribution will be to share with you what we understand according to the impact of discrete variable in the process of performing flexibility area. At the beginning, I will show you a small example in order to understand the impact of discrete variable. And to resume this impact. And after that, I will present a meta-heuristic approach in order to find the sub area in the flexibility area and to ensure the feasibility of all parts of some parts of the flexibility area, doing an intelligent inspection in the third space. And at the end of the process, we'll be able to empower the network operator with useful information in order to manage the flexibility area located in the distribution network. And at the end, in order to conclude, I will present some benefits of the flexibility area during the collaboration process between TSO and DSO. In order to understand the impact of discrete variable, let's consider a small network, the modified version of the IEEE 9-bus test system with four flexibility resources. We have the consumer's charge, wind park, OLTC transformer, and synchronous compensator. With a tolerance of 10 degree, you will get the first flexibility area. But if we reduce the tolerance, the flexibility area will be represented by the next, the second plot. The difference between the two plots is the definition of the perimeter of the flexibility area. With lower tolerance, we will get more defined flexibility area, but this also will increase the computational effort. This was done considering a continuous variable, but if we change the synchronous compensator by a capacitor bank with 50% of step length and the OLTC with only three taps position, 95, 100 and 105% of the tap position, we have 9 combination of the discrete variable. In this case, we showed it in order to be able to study all the combination. The figure you have seen now, you can see that only 5 of this combination leads to a feasible flexibility area. For 4 combination of discrete variable, the OPF process could not converge because there was not a feasible point associated to this composition. If we put together the result of the enumeration process and the result of the continuous variable process result, we can see that the region in red represents the result using the continuous variable, and the green region were obtained by using only discrete variable. Only value of discrete variable. You can see that the red region is higher than the sum of the green region. And the green region don't cover all the red region. So the red region which are not covered by the green region are unfeasible region due to the behavior of discrete variable. So only joining the external points of the green variable, we cannot say that all the points inside the convex hull of the vectors of the obtained points represents the flexibility area. Inside the flexibility area, we have unfeasible points. And how are we going to solve this problem? Here, we have proposed a meta-heuristic approach in order to carry out an intelligent inspection of the research space, because the first flexibility area we can present to the operator of the system is not feasible. Not all the points are feasible. A population-based meta-heuristic would be suitable to tackle the problem, but the computational effort could be too much. So we have to define an objective function in order to inform the operator of the system which region of the first flexibility area are really feasible. So the flexibility area would be computed for each individual of the population, and the efforts could be too much. So the suggestion here is to apply a single solution-based meta heuristic in order to inspect all only interesting region indicated by the operator of the system. So at the beginning, we'll provide the original algorithm with the original algorithm, the flexibility area, relaxing the discrete variable. And then for point chosen by the operator, we'll check if they are feasible or not. If a point is feasible, a point chosen or indicated by the operator is feasible, we can now compute the sub area surrounding this point, and then we will provide to the operator the combination of setting points leading to the maximum, the largest flexibility area around the chosen point. For doing so, we use the variable neighborhood search in order to perform a local search. We are not needing to explore all the initial flexibility area, but according to the point chosen by the operator, we can search around it in order to get the largest sub-area to be given to the operator. So at the beginning, we have the combination of discrete variable that lead to the user operating point at the initial solution. So we have a solution. We are sure that it's working. We can now compute the flexibility area surrounding it. Here, for the shaking neighborhood definition, we use the possibility to move two position upper and two position down in order to search neighbor of our initial solution. And for performing the neighbor objective function, we will disturb our population, our individual, in one of his positions. So we will disturb one of the discrete variable. And our objective function will be the area of a polygon represented by the vertex of the points we already found. And if we find a point with a better objective function, we will keep it, and this will be our new solution. And at the end of the process, by maximizing the objective function, we can provide the largest flexibility area surrounding our initial point. In the figure you have on your right, you have the initial point, the almost yellow point. The yellow point is the point chosen by the operator, and the blue area, it was the first solution, the first combination of discrete variable. But with the optimization process, we can increase the flexibility area, finding another combination of discrete variable leading to a larger flexibility area. In this case, by the optimization process, we get an increase of more than 87% of the first, the initial flexibility area. At the end of the process, we can provide the operator of this, the system, with the combination, the set point, the best set point in terms of OLTC and capacitor bank, in order to find the most, the largest flexibility area. What are the benefits of providing a flexibility area? By providing the flexibility area, we are providing to the operator of the transmission system and the operator of the distribution system the knowledge about degree of flexibility in the operating point to the primary substation. So this information is crucial to support coordinated flexibility activation procedure between DSO and TSO, so the operator of the transmission system and the distributions. Doing so, we are avoiding unfeasible requests of flexibility by the TSO. Having the flexibility area, the TSO can have the information of what are the feasible region and what are not. So he cannot make requests to the TSO knowing that these requests are not feasible. Also, the flexibility area will give an information to the network planner in order to assess the impact of additional flexibility resource to be, if you need to increase flexibility. The flexibility area will give the information according to how we are close to the network limits or not. If you are already reaching the limit of our network, even if we add more flexible resources, we will not get more flexibility at the TSO and DSO interface. We need to improve, we need to upgrade our network. This will also enhance the accuracy in the definition of contractual value, because we are in a liberalized market. So the flexibility area will give an information in order to understand how much contracts we can sign, or the operator of the system can sign with the owner of flexibility, in order to avoid problem that can arise in the management of the system. So this concept of flexibility area will increase the degree of collaboration, giving more information to the operator of the transmission system and the distribution system. As now we can say that the distribution system is becoming like another kind of transmission system, with all the resources connected to the distribution system, with the flexibility they are introducing in the system. Now with the renewable source, we have a higher degree of uncertainty according to the renewable behavior of wind or solar. So we hope that the knowing, the knowledge of the flexibility area, it's an interesting point in order to increase the collaboration between a transmission system operator and distribution system operator. I hope that I was clear in my explanation, but I'm available for questions or comments from the audience. my email and the email of João will be available if you want to continue this discussion even after this webinar. So, Ricardo, I've finished.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so we have now here's five questions on the Q&A. So if you want to also to make a live question, you can also raise your hand and then I move you to a speaker. I will start with the Q&A. So we have one question from Mohamed Javadi. Is there any possibility to use convex feasible operating region for PQ to reduce the computational burden? So he refers some work on combined heat and power units that is using this technique.
Sorry, Ricardo, can you please repeat the question?
The reference is to a technique called convex feasible operating region. If we could use this to reduce the computational burden of the estimation.
This already has been used in the first approach, because if you remember the presentation of João, we have two approaches. One is based on the convexity of the flexibility region. So this will allow us to avoid exploration of region where we know that we'll not have new points, or this new point will not give more information. This is the first concept, exploiting the convexity of the flexibility area. But we discovered that in some case, very little case, the flexibility area could be non-convex. In this case, as presented by João, we have to change the approach. In this case, we have to find a feasible point inside the flexibility area and then use another approach according to what João presented before and calculate the coordinate of the perimeter of flexibility area in a zone where the flexibility area is not convex.
Okay. Yes, I think just to complement your answer, we started in the beginning with a brute force approach that was a Monte Carlo that was exploring all the points. Then we had an optimization approach that was not very efficient. And then with this approach based on the convex hull, we managed to decrease a lot the computational time. Okay, so another question from Wilson Gonzalez Vanegas. The question is if we have used a three-phase load flow for the distribution grid to calculate these TSO-DSO maps.
For the results we present here, we didn't use the three-phase model for distribution system. But this will be the next step. Yeah. As we know that distribution system could be very unbalanced.
Yeah, although here in medium voltage grid and high voltage grid where we apply these, the question of being imbalanced is not so relevant as in the low voltage grid in Europe. That's also the reason why we use a balanced approach.
Yeah, but as you know, for American grid, even the medium voltage distribution system could be very, very unbalanced. So this could be a next step for this concept.
Okay, so one more question for Martin Bolfek is if we are including load and flexibility uncertainty in the method.
For the results we have presented here, we didn't include the uncertainty, but also this one will be the next step. We are working on this. Instead of having a flexibility area, as it was presented here, maybe we'll have some nuances of the flexibility area, saying that some regions are more probable than other. Yeah.
Okay.
So we can we can add a scale of color on the flexibility area, as we do it for the flexibility cost map. We can do it also. We can also do it increasing the information according to the probability of occurrence of these kinds of distributed resources.
Okay, Jean. So one more question is if we can provide a reference for this second presentation you made about the use of the meta-heuristics. Is this already published in a conference or a journal paper?
Not yet, but it will be soon. Yeah, it will be published soon. So be patient. In a couple months, maybe you can get the next publication from us introducing the use of meta-heuristic in order to find sub-area of flexibility.
Okay. So this leads to another question or a comment we have here from João Cantalão. There is already a special issue open and accepting submission of abstracts until the 1st of July, exactly for this topic. So real-world challenges of TSO and DSO coordination. So for you and for the others that have the opportunity and they are working on this, you have the opportunity to submit an abstract to this special issue, and then if accepted, to submit the full paper.
We are planning to submit at least two or three abstracts for this special issue.
Okay. So one question here from José Villar. How is the simultaneous provision of active and reactive power priced by the flexibility providers? So in this case, on one side, if we are considering the cost in the maps, I will price reactive power, and now an agent can offer the two products with different prices. So do you have an idea for this?
In this study, we didn't focus on the price, how the price are made. We are considering that the price is already defined, and this is one of the inputs of our system. Yeah. We are not entering in the negotiation of in the market. So we are considering that the price are already defined.
Okay. So another question is how optimal scheduling can be managed and practically implemented with regards to virtual power plants.
The method we have presented here can also be used for virtual power plants. As João mentioned before, if you see the work published by Pierluigi Mancarella, I don't remember the name of the first author, but you can see that a similar approach can be used for virtual power plants.
Okay, so it's also important to explain related to this question that the flexibility from these VPPs, they are not optimized by this approach of RDS2. What we use is you make an offer of flexibility band and we include that available flexibility on the model to estimate how much flexibility can the whole grid provide considering the constraints. So it's not a tool or an approach that can be used to optimize VPPs. Somehow outside the scope of this approach. So there is one question about if the presentations will be available. So you will receive all by email the video from this webinar. If you want the slides, you can contact also the two authors and request the slides or send an email to the generic email that is here on the presentation of, that was in the end of the presentation of Jean, and we also have here the contacts of the two speakers. So one question from Clara Gouveia, How would this approach be applicable considering the use of flexibility by the DSO? So I think this flexibility by the DSO, she refers to OLTCs, capacitor banks. So,
okay. To be honest, I didn't understand the question. Yeah. Can you please?
How we will apply this approach considering the use of flexibility by the DSO?
Yeah. So the DSO can use the flexibility to solve problem occurred within the distribution system. But the DSO can also use this information in order to find what will be the optimal use of the flexibility according to a request of the transmission system operator. If the transmission system operator asks to the DSO to move from an operating point to another operating point, what will be the optimal activation of flexibility resource in the distribution in order to achieve comply with the TSO demand? This also has been done within the Evolve DSO project. I think you can find it on the report of the Evolve DSO project.
Yeah, well, I think here the question of Clara, she also had a clarification below, was also related with the model of activation of flexibility. So in one side, you could have the DSO building these flexibility maps only with the flexibility that he does not plan to use.
Okay.
So we will inform how much flexibility is available on that distribution grid without the flexibility offers that the DSO plan to use. That is one model, for example, but it could be the other way around. So having the DSO requesting this information about flexibility from the DSO side, asking him to move the operating point, as you said, and only the remaining flexibility could be used by the DSO. We didn't address on the tool, the tool is agnostic of the model for TSO-DSO coordination. It can be used for both models or for any other model that is foreseen. So in that sense, it's agnostic of who have priority over the activation of flexibility. Okay, so one question here is, how is price forecasting incorporated among TSO and DSO?
As I said before, we didn't focus on how price are calculated. We assume that the price are already calculated and they are an input for our model.
Okay. So one question from an anonymous attendee. In fact, it's a quite interesting question. I also had it here on my list to make you questions. It's about the reconfiguration. So the option of making reconfiguration on the grid and the flexibility that it provides. So is there any limitation in the method if you want to include also network reconfiguration as a flexibility option?
Here we have two possibilities. If the distribution network can be connected through more than one interface point, or if we are only using one interface point, and then the reconfiguration would change completely the flexibility map. So we can also explore all the configuration made available by reconfiguration in order to see if we can increase or not the flexibility area provided to the TSO. So this will add more discrete variable to the problem.
Okay, so also related with that, but more with the computational time. So one question from Mario Couto, it's what is the computational time of these approaches? If they are designed for day ahead and intraday market?
For performing a flexibility area using real network, this is doing in less than 2 seconds. So we can compute it almost in real time.
But this less than 2 seconds is for a network of which size? How many nodes have that network?
We are talking about hundreds of nodes.
There is one question about that. If this was computed for a 9-bus network, can you give an idea about the size?
For nine bus network, we cannot count the time because you get already the result. But according to the tests we made with EDP or with Enedit in France, with almost 1,000 nodes, you can get the answer in less than 2 or 3 seconds.
Yeah, I think we made tests with a network that have more than 8,000 nodes, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah.
Was quite intense.
So this is not also in one of the paper, I think it's a paper of Contreras, they talk about 15 minutes, but this is not true. With our tool we are doing it in seconds.
Yes, the optimal power flow that we use as a core algorithm for the tool is very efficient, and we have compared it with MAT power and even with PSSE, and it's in terms of computational time, it's very good. In some cases, outperform commercial OPFs. Okay, so one more question. So in the practical scenario, who is responsible for calculating the flexibility area, the TSO or the DSO?
The DSO is responsible for calculating the flexibility area and will give this information to the TSO.
Okay. So one question, also two more questions from Wilson Vanagas. So how is the role of the aggregator being taken into account? So how do you consider the aggregator here? What is the role?
In this approach, we are not considering the role of the aggregator, but I think that in the next future, the aggregator will also need to run this kind of tools in order to see what is the flexibility it can offer to the distribution operator system of the system.
Okay. So
with the aggregator, we'll have another problem because all the flexibility resources of an aggregator could not be connected to the same point. They could be dispersed on the distribution system.
Okay, so one more question. So to which extent these flexibility markets can, flexibility maps can be related with the concept of hosting capacity?
Yeah, somehow, yes, we can connect it to the hosting capacity. But it's not the same things, but there is some correlation between hosting capacity calculation and flexibility offered to the transmission system.
Yeah, we could say that we also in Evolve DSO, we made a small test for InnoG in Germany, where the idea was to see how could you increase the map on the interface with the TSO by installing more storage and having more flexible resources.
Yeah.
So somehow this allowed them to understand if with this additional flexibility that was being installed on the grid, if the flexibility map increases or decreases. So somehow this is related with the hosting capacity of that specific node. But that was not the main case study. Okay, so we answer all the questions. I don't know if we have more questions or someone that wants to...
Or comments.
Question or comments or suggestions of improvement. Yeah. Okay, so we are on time. So if we don't have more questions, we could end the webinar here. So thank you. Thanks. João, I hope the defense, the public defense of João is going well. We'll check that after this webinar. And thanks also for all the attenders. So as I said, the video will be sent by email. If you want the slides, you can also contact the speakers. Now we will start planning the next webinar, or probably in June or July, we'll have a new webinar from this series. Thank you, everyone. Have a nice weekend. Bye.
Bye.